So, quick discussion of a case: 25-year-old male complaining of left-sided, gradual insidious onset, medial knee pain. He described it as a sort of stiffness and an ache, and said it was getting worse as the weather got colder. This is October last year. Then he started reporting these sort of bouts of sharp pain. He said it was when he was putting in the washing up and when he kind of reached that full knee extension. Led him to go to his GP, who told him to self-refer through physio. Kind of at the top end, severity wise, 6 out of 10, and then there were periods where it's totally absent. Location wise, it was poorly localized. Generally, he sort of indicated when I first asked him this, it was like sort of peripatella running outside of that kneecap. I mean, so broadly one anterior for the most part, around his patella. And so there are certain conditions where you can, where you can be led quite a lot by the location. Certain conditions will generally have a typically more localized pain pattern, like when it comes to anterior knee pain, things like your patellar tendon, tendinopathies, to that inferior pole, your Hofer's fat pad syndrome, sort of medial and/or lateral to the when you're palpating to the actual patellar tendon itself. But things like patellofemoral joint pain, I mean, it can generally, if you talk about the classic, it can be retro or peripatellar, around those kind of facets. But it can generally be a bit more vague, and can even refer posteriorly. So just something to bear in mind. So initially, I was kind of given his age as well. I'm sort of, but patellofemoral pain syndrome is in my mind sort of more a diagnosis of exclusion. So it's on my list there now, but given what he's told me, but I'm gonna check for other things first and then see what we're, process elimination and see what we're left with. So I'm thinking that, but then the thing that throws me off is that generally he was sort of saying that his aggravating factors were kicking. That terminal knee extension, walking, both extension based activities, the knees in extension essentially, which is less likely to be because generally patellofemoral is more flexion based activities. Now, he did say that prolonged sitting, that kind of typical moviegoer's knee, about 15 to 20 minutes, was sore, and he did get relief, sort of change of position, extending his knee out. So there's a kind of conflicting sort of statements here, and sort of information being reported that starts to kind of pollute that that a diagnosis of patellofemoral pain syndrome. Anyway, easing factors was he clicked his knee and he felt some relief off that, and we went through special questions. No swelling, giving way, yes, sagittal plane when descending the stairs, and generally, I mean, he's had, he's not a sudden acute contact or traumatic in the injury with a pop or a crack or rotary instability, you would get an ACL. This is probably more likely a kind of pseudo instability, so to speak, or a quadriceps insufficiency inhibition, a pain inhibition, because your quads are going to be active in decelerating that knee extension. But when he, I'll talk about this now. So he was reporting knee clicking, not painful, but more frequently than he was used to, and that kind of popping and clicking that he kept talking about. Now I'm starting to think maybe there's some kind of meniscal pathology there, because it doesn't, I mean, it can be a sudden onset, but not necessarily always. So that's starting to get up there in my differential diagnosis from that information. Anyway, when I'm thinking about rationale for why you might be getting that pain, say during the stairs, is that when you descend down, a lot of times the shin angle, so that's your tibia, here's your femur, if the shin angle starts to kind of lean forwards, it creates this potential for kind of shear, and those femoral condyles for shearing across the tibial plateau. If you've got an irritated meniscus, it won't like that. you get that pain inhibition in quads go, and then you get that. And now they're unable to decelerate and control that sort of knee flexion, so you get a moment of that. So that's why I'm thinking about it in my mind. No red flags as such. I mean, he did report pain worse at night, but when we really peeled it back, he was able to find comfortable positions. So we're kind of relatively happy when we never rule out the red flags. We always remain vigilant for them, but it definitely seems like more of a mechanical picture from what he said. No threads. No, the only significant past medical history was actually a family history of a really, his mum had bilateral knee replacements before even the age of 50. It's due to arthritis, and he said something about his auntie was wheelchair bound since age 26 due to some kind of arthritis. So really, I mean, incredibly early onset arthritis. Maybe it could have been some. More an inflammatory arthritis, like a sort of your RAs potentially, but or gout, something like that. But with the auntie at least, but he wasn't sure which one it was. So anyway, keeping that in my mind as well, as we go through. So when we get to the examination, look at his squat first. And now if you're patellofemoral, if you're a patellofemoral type person, I'm expecting you to get your pain deeper into the squat as those joint reaction forces get higher. If you're sort of more of a patellotendinopathy, I'm thinking earlier, that more 30, 45 degrees. And sometimes I might even do a decline squat to load the quadriceps even more if I'm suspicious of that. But I wasn't really suspicious of patellotendinopathy with him. So we did get our asterisk functional asterisk sign with the squat. 4 out of 10, and it was his pain at 80 degrees knee flexion, so it was deeper. It was anterior knee pain. Repositioning test, I repositioned his subtalar joint into kind of just more of a neutral, supinated it, and it got rid of his pain entirely. He could squat full depth, so that was a really good buy-in, great straight away, and showed starts to maybe steer where our management will go, because he did have a lot of dynamic knee valgus when he was doing that. His range of motion then was limited to end range extension, painful. Couldn't achieve end range extension passively or any overpressure on either that or flexion. And now it's medial, and he had medial joint line pain, and that's where he's reporting his pain during those. So this is looking very strongly meniscus now. Because in that clinical prediction rule, he's ticking a lot of those boxes. So our diagnostic likelihood of him having that is, and we've got three now, so it's very likely that he has that. There was some retropatellar pain on the medial facet, but now, I mean, even if there is the presence of that, and I mean, biomechanically speaking, if he's got that dynamic knee valgus, he's going to reduce the surface area of contact on that lateral facet of the patella, and increase loading on that aspect. I always think of it as like the tracks moving out of the way of the train, but leading to that kind of biomechanical stress on the articular side of the patella. So there could be some of that, but it's definitely not the kind of priority, I suppose, for want of a better description. Now it's the meniscus, and his McNairy's was positive with medial bias. His Applius was positive with a medial meniscus bias. And what I sometimes do is I kind of compress, perform the maneuver, then I wait till the pain settles, distract, do the same thing. And if you're distracting and you're rotating, the pain goes, which his did, and then you are starting to think that it's more the meniscus as opposed to some kind of, ligamentous soft tissue issue. That was it. We left it there. So I've done a referral for him, because especially he wants to get. He's a free runner, so we had a really good chat about free running, common ground there. Build up some rapport, which is awesome. Given that family history of the early knee replacements and the osteoarthritis, and that he wants to kind of get back into free running, We're going to start with conservative management anyway, but I feel much more comfortable referring getting an orthopedic opinion on whether early surgical management would be favourable to best outcomes. And as to what surgery they go for, we don't know. There's a bunch. It might be as simple as needing a bit of a debridement. It might be repair. It might be microfracture. I couldn't say until we find out more from that end. But generally speaking, unless I mean the outer third of the meniscus is more vascular, so if you have a tear in that area, sometimes it can just get better with, just pure rehab and rest. And if it's an older if it's an older, population, their desire to get back to physical activity, or their level of physical activity is just normal ADLs, then I'm less inclined to kind of refer to the for the surgical opinion, just because the benefit to risk doesn't make any sense. It's much more in favour of trying a conservative management. And I think what we're probably going to do with him is just trial a period for a few weeks, assess the response, and if we're not getting where we want to be, I've already set the ball in motion, so I'll be able to have the probably imaging and surgical opinion before we even get to that point. So that's it. Hope for anybody watching that's useful.